So this is a short film about Stalin and political power, political control, how he exercised it, and what his purpose was. Primarily, his purpose was to extend and consolidate his own power over the Soviet Union and to make sure that he was completely unassailable, completely untouchable as leader of the Soviet Union. And the main method he used to try and achieve that aim was the purge, the getting rid of opponents. Now, this wasn't something that was completely new to the Bolshevik Party. Lenin had been prepared to purge people in the early 1920s. For example, during the Civil War, Lenin's treatment of the so-called kulaks had been pretty violent. And also, so had Trotsky's treatment of the naval men who mutinied at Kronstadt in the Kronstadt naval base in 1921, been pretty violent. So had Trotsky's crushing of the trade unions earlier, and the expulsion of Trotsky from the party in the late 1920s and from the country in the late 1920s had been a pretty violent act. But Stalin took these kind of levels of violence that had occurred earlier in the Bolshevik Party to new and pretty horrific levels. It began really, the first signs that Stalin was prepared to use terror and purges as a means of political control and establishing political power was in 1928 when a group of miners at a place called Shakhty, in the Donbass region, were accused of committing industrial sabotage, i.e., they were accused as being deliberately underproducing the amount of coal that the 5-year plan had called for, and they were put on trial for sabotage, for trying to undermine the industrial objectives of the country, and 5 of them were sentenced to death. And 44 of them were sentenced to prison. That was probably the earliest example of any kind of political purging. There was a slight pause then until the early 1930s. In 1932, a group of politicians led by a man called Ryutin, who had been an old Bolshevik, who'd been a member of the Bolshevik Party before the October Revolution, he had become opposed to the speed and scale of collectivization and of industrialization that Stalin had undertook with a great turn. And he'd written a pamphlet about this and distributed it amongst people who had fallen foul of Stalin, fallen out of favor with Stalin. And Stalin uncovered this group of people and accused them of a conspiracy to try and sabotage the country, to try and sabotage the nation, accused them of all kinds of fantastic crimes, of conspiring with foreign enemies, of trying to undermine the nation. And they were arrested and sent off to prison camps. This was the prelude to the beginning of a purge of the Bolshevik Party. Between 1933 and 1934, 1 million members, that's a third of the members of the Bolshevik Party, were expelled from the party for being politically suspect. They weren't at this moment imprisoned or sent off to labor camps, and they weren't at this point shot. Those are the features of the later purges that didn't happen until the late 1930s. But this was a sign of the kind of behaviour that Stalin was prepared to resort to. And it was a big blow to those million people that lost their membership of the Communist Party, because membership meant privileges. It meant having access to better housing, better education for your children. It meant access to job and promotion opportunities. It meant better food rations. So taking that away from 1 million people was a blow to those people. But the real purges, the infamous purges as we know them, the mass arrests, the mass deportations, the mass exportation, the mass execution of people, didn't really begin until 1935. And the catalyst for them was the execution, was the murder in December 1934 of a popular Soviet politician, a man called Sergei Kirov. He was the chairman of the Leningrad Soviet, and he'd been elected to the Politburo, the cabinet, in 1934. But he'd become quite a critic of the Stalinist economic policy of rapid industrialization and forced collectivization. And he was calling for a softer, well, a more lenient approach to the peasants and a more steady approach to the industrialization of the country. He thought he was causing far too much turbulence and dislocation. Then he was shot and killed in December 1934. And it's probably the case that Stalin, it's never been definitively proved, but it's probably the case that Stalin was involved or planned it, or was at least aware of the plot to kill Kirov, because it played into his hands. It played into to Stalin's advantage. Stalin used Kirov's murder as an excuse to pass a decree. He passed a decree called the Decree Against Terrorist Acts on the 1st of December 1934. And he used the murder of Kirov as an excuse to hunt out and to imprison and arrest anyone who was alleged to be an opponent of the Soviet regime or a threat to the Soviet regime. And it enabled him to purge people, anyone in the party, principally, who was opposed to Stalin. Stalin claimed that the party was riddled with so-called Trotskyites, people who thought that Trotsky had been unfairly treated, that the party should follow a more Trotskyist line. And Stalin accused these Trotskyites of being in league with foreign agents, of conspiring to bring the party and the Soviet Union down, of being in league with capitalists, and all kinds of fantastic allegations. And so the process of arresting and deporting and imprisoning thousands and thousands of members of the party began, which left empty places within the party that Stalin could fill with people who were more loyal to him. One of the most notable examples of this is Nikita Khrushchev, who Stalin appointed as a chairman of the Moscow City party boss in 1935. And he also had his old colleagues and then his old foes, Kamenev and Zinoviev, arrested in 1935. And this sent a really strong, a really important signal out to anyone who might be thinking of opposing Stalin in some way, that if he had the power now to arrest people like Kamenev and Zinoviev, people who had been at the heart of the Bolshevik Party since before the October Revolution, and had been trusted comrades of Lenin's, if Stalin had the power to arrest people like that, then he had ultimate power over the party. It sent out a very strong signal that you know, if you crossed Stalin, you did it at your peril. By 1936, Stalin was pretty much in total control of the party, but he then decided to go on an even greater purge of the party. He claimed that there were threats to the country from all quarters. He said that there were counter-revolutionaries acting within the party, and he claimed that there were threats in all quarters of the Soviet Union. He claimed that there were threats within the Bolshevik Party, within the armed forces, and even within, you know, the ordinary, within the ranks of the ordinary citizens of the Soviet Union. So from 1936, a number of really important show trials began. In 1936, Kamenev and Zinoviev were put on trial, public trial. It was televised. It was seen in cinemas in the Soviet Union, and they were accused of plotting to overthrow the Soviet state. And they admitted their guilt, they admitted their crime that, yes, they were in league with foreign capitalists to bring down the Soviet state, which is a fantastic thing for, in terms of it being a fantasy, and a fantastic thing for people like Kamenev and Zinoviev to admit to. They must have been subjected to hours, weeks of torture, physical and psychological torture, and brought down to this position where they felt that they had to admit to these kinds of crimes. They admitted to them, They were then executed. In 1937, more leading Bolsheviks were put on trial, and also the following year, in 1935. Primarily, Nikolai Bukharin, who Stalin had been a close ally of when he was conspiring against Trotsky and Zinoviev and Kamenev, and then turned against Bukharin when he'd gone about implementing his so-called Great Turn in 1928. He accused Bukharin and Rykov of conspiring against the Soviet state, and they too confessed to all kinds of fantastic crimes, and they were executed. But it wasn't just members of the Bolshevik Party and leading members of the Bolshevik Party who were purged. It was also leading members of the armed forces. People who had been heroes to the Bolshevik Party for fighting and winning the Civil War. Marshal Tukhachevsky, for example, was accused of being a foreign spy. He was arrested and executed. In fact, between May 1937 and November 1939, there's some amazing figures here. Something like 11 of all commissars of war were sacked. 3 out of 5 marshals in the Soviet army were sacked. 75 out of the 80 supreme military commanders were executed. 14 out of 60 army commanders were removed. Half of all the officers, 35,000 men, were imprisoned or shot. All admirals in the Soviet Navy were shot. Thousands of naval officers were arrested, and only one commander in the Air Force survived the purges. This was going on between 1937 and 1939, at a time when Hitler was clearly gearing up for war and making incredibly belligerent and bellicose statements about the Soviet Union and how he aimed to smash international communism. Stalin decided that that was the best time to virtually dismantle his entire armed forces. It was clearly an absolutely bonkers thing for him to do, but he claimed that there was a conspiracy within the armed forces that needed to be crushed, when of course the real purpose was that he feared that the armed forces might become a centre of resistance and opposition to him, and he wanted to make them subservient. Ordinary people and ordinary workers were also victims of Stalin's purges. Managers of factories or mines or any kind of industrial workplace were accused of industrial sabotage if quotas of the five-year plans weren't met. Ordinary workers were accused of trying to sabotage the Soviet economy if they weren't seen to be working as hard as perhaps they might. It wasn't just in the industrial economy as well. Lawyers, academics, anyone considered of having suspect or anti-Soviet ideas was liable to be arrested, imprisoned, interrogated, tortured, and executed if found guilty. And it didn't take, it wasn't a normal judicial or legal process of having enough evidence to find anyone guilty. If you were suspected of a crime, then you were more often than not found guilty of that crime. Something like 1 in 18 of the general population were arrested during the 1930s. There was a deliberate policy of repression of the people, and people felt terrified. Fear permeated Soviet society. Fear and paranoia and suspicion, fear that your neighbour or your relative might accuse you of being an enemy agent or of conspiring to bring down the state. All of this was masterminded, I suppose. It was at the initiative of Stalin, but the agency that carried it out was the secret police, the NKVD. And at its most frenzied period, between 1937 and 1938, the NKVD was headed by a man called Nikolai Yezhov. And he was the man who, along with Stalin, set quotas for the numbers of people that should be arrested for various regions of the country, various towns of the country. And he and Stalin presided over this vast network of prison camps that operated around the country, the Gulag system. This way of operating even continued during the Second World War. Whilst the Soviet Union was fighting the Nazis, people were still being arrested and still being accused of being foreign agents or foreign spies or conspiring to sabotage or wreck Soviet industry during the Second World War. And even after the Second World War, the same kinds of things continued. In 1947, Stalin decided that he no longer really needed to work with the Politburo or the Central Committee of the Soviet Union and was acting just purely as a dictator. In 1949, he claimed that the Leningrad Party was riddled with people that were conspiring against him and that it needed to be purged. More people were arrested and imprisoned and executed. He became very anti-Semitic as well when his daughter started seeing and having a relationship with a young Jewish man. He became incredibly anti-Semitic and ordered a purge of leading Jewish figures in the Soviet Union. And in 1953, the year of his death, he was planning a purge of the doctors in the Soviet Union, who he claimed had been infiltrated by Jews who were conspiring to bring down the Soviet state. Right up until his death, he continued accusing people of all kinds of unbelievable and fantastic crimes and having them arrested, imprisoned, sent off to camps and executed. Something like about 20 million people were affected by Stalin's purges between the late 1920s and early 1950s. And that doesn't include somewhere between 5 and 10 million people who died as a result of the of collectivization and his economic policy. Stalin is, without doubt, one of history's most appalling and most brutal dictators. He killed millions and millions of people. But he was just one man, and whilst he might have initiated the purges, he needed other people to participate in the process in order for it to happen. We can't, it's too simplistic for us to say what an awful man he was and write him off just as being a, you know, psychopath. There must have been other people involved in the process in order for it to work. People in his party must have taken an active part in the purges. Ordinary people played an active part in the purges. If, for example, you had a feud with a neighbour and you knew that the atmosphere was one that if you went to the police and you accused your neighbour of being guilty of some kind of crime against the state, that they would be arrested and be taken off and perhaps lose their property and perhaps you could somehow benefit from that, there would be a temptation for you to do that. And many people in the Soviet Union did that. It wasn't just high-ranking officials within the Bolshevik Party that played a part during the purges, it was ordinary people as well. Society, to some extent, I suppose, must have tolerated the purges in order for the purges to continue. So, in a sense, the purges must have happened from below, from the ground upwards, from people upwards, perhaps as much as they happened from the top down. But it's quite clear that Stalin initiated and established the purges, and he was incredibly successful at instilling fear in people. But then he was an incredibly fearful person himself, incredibly paranoid, incredibly suspicious, seeing plots everywhere. And he was also an incredibly vindictive person, a person who enjoyed getting his revenge against people. He was undoubtedly a bit of a psychopath. And he created a kind of psychopathic, vindictive, violent society. But he did have total control over the country. And if that was his aim, to establish and extend and consolidate his political control of the country and of his political colleagues, then I suppose we can say he was successful. But at a horrific price, tens of millions of people suffered during the Stalinist era. And that has got to be his legacy.